Have you ever wondered how the territory of Ukraine had changed from this, through this, through this? Did you know that some recent events made some territorial changes considering Ukraine? For that, I advise you to watch the video till the end. In this video, we're going to talk about the territorial changes of Ukraine during the 20th century. Hey, welcome. If this is your first time on this channel, I'm a history teacher hustling history for you. And the only thing you have to do is make sure to subscribe. Also hit the notification bell to join the hustle. Let's start. Ukraine started in the 20th century as a non-existent country, meaning that it was not a sovereign nation. What is now Ukraine used to be part in the west of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and the bulk of it was part of the Russian Empire. 1914, the First World War breaks out, and the Russian Empire and the Austro-Hungarian Empire are now against each other. That same year, the Russians managed to overrun the eastern part of Galicia, with Lviv, back in the day called Lemberg, as its capital. They occupied only to be driven out by an Austrian-Hungarian and German offensive the following year. 1917. Now here it gets interesting, because in February that year, the Russian Revolution breaks out. Social Democrats gain power in Petrograd, now St. Petersburg, and they set up a provisional government. Now in Ukraine, Ukrainian nationalists, they set up the UNR, Ukrainian Nationalist Republic, but they declared themselves loyal to the newly created Russian government. But when in October that year, the communists, the Bolsheviks, gained power in Petrograd, the UNR declares itself independent from Russia. The Bolsheviks, who had set up their communist government in the Ukrainian city of Kharkiv, they launched an offensive and they captured Kiev. And they are now in charge. March 1918. Bolshevik Russia signs a peace treaty with the German Empire, known as the Brest-Litovsk Peace Treaty. This leaves large areas of land in the German sphere of influence, and so also Ukraine. Therefore, the Germans set up a pro-German puppet government under the leadership of the Russian general Pavlo Skoropadsky. The state is also known as the Hetmanate. 11 November 1918, World War I is over, and the Germans are forced to retreat from their territories. They have to leave Ukraine. Now, the Bolsheviks, they want to try to grab as much land as possible, and so they do. So they take Kiev and take control of Ukraine. Now, in the western part of Ukraine, which once belonged to the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which was also defeated in the First World War, Ukrainian nationalists, they set up their West Ukrainian People's Republic, independent state. Now, they get into fighting with the Poles, because the Polish wanted to expand their newly created Second Polish Republic, and also because many Polish people were living in Galicia, Galicia had to become part of Poland. So the Poles attack. Now, during this whole mess, multiple short-lived Ukrainian states existed, such as the Komansa Republic, the Lemko Republic, the Crimean People's Republic, the Don Republic, the Kuban People's Republic. The last two are actually mostly located in what is now Russia, but just for the sake of completion. And if I miss anything else, feel free to comment down below. Okay, if this is not already complicated enough for you, what follows is a whole string of conflicts, which are partly known as the Ukrainian War of Independence, part of the Russian Civil War, where basically the Reds are fighting the Whites, but then there's also the Blacks. Flash forward to 1921, the biggest part of Ukraine is integrated as the so-called Ukrainian Soviet Socialist Republic into the Soviet Union. The western part of Ukraine, which was Galicia became part of the Second Polish Republic. So most of Ukraine now found itself under Bolshevik control. In the beginning of the 30s, Soviet leader Joseph Stalin unleashed a man-made famine in which millions of Ukrainians perished. Also, during the Great Purge, many Ukrainians were prosecuted and deported or executed. 1939, before the outbreak of the Second World War, there was a very, very short-lived Ukrainian state called Carpato-Ukraine. It basically proclaimed itself independent from Slovakia when Czech was invaded by the Nazis and Slovakia became a Nazi puppet state. After this, the Hungarian army, allies of the Nazis, marched in and ended this very short-lived republic. The Carpato-Ukraine had existed for one day. Later, the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact was signed between Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union. September that year, the Nazis invaded Poland from the west, the Soviets from the east, and they carved up what was known as the Second Polish Republic. Poland was no more. The eastern parts of Poland were annexed by the Soviet Union, and thus the Ukrainian SSR was extended with the region of Galicia. June 1941, Nazi Germany invades the Soviet Union. Death and destruction all over the place. Ukrainian nationalists, they saw this as an opportunity to declare an independent Ukrainian state. And this was done by Stepan Bandera. But the Nazis, they were like, no. And they basically disbanded this. And Ukrainian nationalists now found themselves prosecuted by the Nazis. Now, those who weren't caught, they eventually helped the Nazis with killing of Jews and later Poles. At the end of the war, and even many years after the war, many of these Ukrainian nationalists will be hunted down by Soviet agents. 1944, the Nazis are pushed out of Ukraine. Now, annexed by the Soviet Union, and basically an extension of the Ukrainian SSR, is now what was previously known as Carpato-Ukraine, and also the Izmael region, south of what is now Moldova, became part of the Ukrainian SSR. And the territories that once belonged to Eastern Poland, they become permanently annexed by the Soviet Union. And thus also the region of Galicia. And this explains why Lviv, which was previously known as Lvov, and before that Lemberg, is, although its Polish appearance, a Ukrainian city as of today. During these years, ethnic homogenization took place. What does this mean? Well, basically, Poles had to go to Poland. Ukrainians had to go to Ukraine. Germans had to go to Germany. And then there was also Operation Fistula, launched by the Polish Communist government. Timothy Snyder wrote about this the following. Operation Fistula was supposed to force Ukrainians in Poland, or at least their children, to assimilate into Polish culture. At the same time, Polish forces defeated the units of the Ukrainian Partisan Army, the UPA, the Ukrainian Nationalists, on Polish soil. And on Stalin's orders, thousands of Ukrainians, nationalists or not, were deported. It's a sad aftermath of the Second World War in Eastern Poland and Western Ukraine. Then 1954, the Crimean Oblast is transferred to the Ukrainian SSR. Now bear in mind that all of the territories were just still part of the Soviet Union, which was at the end a highly centralized state. It is more of a symbolic gesture because of the 300th anniversary of the Tsardom in Russia. As Soviet newspaper Pravda wrote, taking into account the integral character of the economy, the territorial proximity, and the close economic and cultural ties between the Crimean province and the Ukrainian SSR. Now, other sources say that Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev was drunk at the moment when he decided the Crimea province to be transferred. In any case, it led to problems later down the road. First is 1991, because of the liberal policies by Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev, hardline communists perpetrated a coup in August, which failed. Now after this, the Ukrainian SSR proclaimed itself independent, which was made official after a referendum in December. And a few weeks later, at the end of 1991, the Soviet Union officially dissolved. As we see in many post-communist states, the economy went bad after independence. Now in 2003, pro-Russian candidate Yanukovych wins the Ukrainian elections. It turned out that the elections were rigged. After protests, which became known as the Orange Revolution, Yanukovych steps down. In 2010, however, he wins the elections and he promises EU membership, but also he negotiates with the Russians. In 2013, the public, they had enough of it, and they started a protest on Maidan Square in the capital of Kyiv. Yanukovych sent in his troops, shots were fired, and over 100 Ukrainians died during these protests. The protest held out for 3 months, and in the end, Yanukovych stepped down and fled to Russia. The pro-EU protesters had won. In the east of Ukraine, it was a different story. There, pro-Russian protesters made their move in Crimea. Crimea is mostly inhabited by ethnic Russians. At that point, Russia itself stepped in, seized control of Crimea, and they held a referendum. And most of the Crimean voters, they voted for becoming part of the Russian Federation. And so it happened. Putin proclaimed Crimea as a part of Russia. The international community, however, does not, and they laid sanctions on Russia. Now, a friend of mine, she's from Lviv, and when the whole mess started, there were rumors in Lviv that the Poles would perhaps come in and try to take Lviv back. Now, luckily, that didn't happen. I mean, what would be next? Germany try to take back Pomerania and Silesia? At the end, in Western Ukraine, everything went peaceful. But in the East, it did not. Because there, we had the Ukrainian provinces of Donetsk and Luhansk. And pro-Russian separatists proclaimed their own independent states. The Luhansk People's Republic and the Donetsk People's Republic. Yeah, so much for the originality of the names. Now, these states are set up by pro-Russian separatists. The Ukrainian military, they tried to subdue this, but they got into fighting, and this led to the war in Donbass, because Russia supports, obviously, the pro-Russian separatists. This conflict, known as the Donbass War, and has transformed into a stalemate. As of now, tens of thousands of people had died and over a million had fled. Often now and then, there's a ceasefire, but it is constantly violated. So it's a stalemate that drags on to this day. Now, a lot of YouTubers say that the conflict in Ukraine is complicated, but is it really? I mean, I don't think so. It is pro-EU Ukrainians in the West versus pro-Russian Ukrainians in the East, simply put. Now, the reason why many people say it's complicated is that they can't make a narrative out of it. And why can't we make a narrative out of the Donbass War? It is basically because it's still ongoing. We don't know how it's going to end. Let's just say the Ukrainian military launches a massive offensive, incorporates the Donetsk and Luhansk regions back into Ukraine, suppresses pro-Russian sentiments violently, violating human rights en masse, transforming Ukraine into a police state nobody wants to be associated with. Or what just if Russia invades Ukraine en masse? Then the Donbass War is a prelude to a bigger war. Or what if this all starts World War III? Then the Donbass War becomes one of the direct causes to it. Now, obviously, I'm just speculating here, and many of the scenarios I don't find likely to happen. I find it hard to form an opinion about the whole situation. So for that, I want to quote the Ukrainian documentary Winter of Fire. She said, "It is said that after all these wars from the past, people are still trying to solve conflicts by killing each other." So it seems that peace in Ukraine might be a long way off, or is it not? What do you think? Feel free to leave a comment down below. Now, if you want to know more about this complicated Ukrainian War of Independence, you want to get your hands dirty and dive into it, it's right here for you. Please consider becoming a patron, because with your donations, I can elevate the hustling of history to a next level. Thank you so much for watching. Do not forget to subscribe. Until next time.